Welcome to the Renaissance and welcome to Capitalism, Feudalism and Slavery for Negroes, Part 1. And this very important notice to you, our dear viewer, that it is never our intention to offend anyone with our videos. It is not also our intention to suggest, insinuate or preach hate towards any group, race, tribe or person. There is also no propaganda or any deliberate attempt to misinform anyone with our videos. Please look for the books, journals, magazines, or other publications or sources referenced and study them yourself. Remember, in geography, the races were described in conformity with the program of the usual propaganda to engender in whites a race hate of the Negro and in the Negroes contempt for themselves. Cather G. Woodson in the book The Miseducation of the Negro. And from Marcus Garvey, we of the Negro race are suffering more than any other race in the world from propaganda. Propaganda to destroy our hopes, our ambitions and confidence in self. Propaganda has done more to defeat the good intentions of races and nations than even open warfare, feudalism, slavery and capitalism. Have you ever taken time to look into the history of all these, as in feudalism, slavery and capitalism? Have you ever tried to relate them to Negro slavery? Have you ever wondered how the slave trade was actually carried out and why it required military force to stop? And do you ever wonder how a trade could have required military force to stop? Remember, trade is, ideally, you bring something, we exchange it for whatever the medium of exchange could be. But in this case, they tell you it was slave trade, but it required British military might to stop it, even though they were previously at the forefront of the slave trade itself. Have you wondered why the trade required military might to stop? Have you also ever looked at the economic and political aspects of the slave trade? Did you study European history in school? What do you know about feudalism? Do you see any relationship between the feudal triangle and the Masonic triangle and the triangle or pyramid you see behind your $1 bill? Have you also ever looked at capitalism and feudalism and societies that live by them, like the British? Have you ever looked at capitalism in detail and what it entails? Have you also examined European conquest of Guinea, Negroland and what you call West and Central Africa today, and that's ideally southern part of Nigeria and then of course a little part of what you call Northern Nigeria today? Have you examined what they were, why the southern part was a protectorate and the northern part was a colony during the slave trade or during colonialism? Have you looked at all those? And do you see any links between European conquest or Arab conquest or the Moorish conquest and the slave trade? Do you see the links? Have you looked out for them? Have you researched them? And when we say research here, we do not mean the one you do in your school, where you limit yourself to the curriculum set forth by the slave master. Capitalism. And before we go forward, we will want to remind you that what we talk about here is totally different from what the slave master talks about in his class. And you have to also remember that most of the terms we use are, for lack of a better word. However, they help us to pass the messages across. And so, to look at capitalism, let us reference the Encyclopedia Britannica, a dictionary of arts, sciences, literature and general information, 11th edition, volume 4, and this was published 1910, and there we are told that capital, that is, capital stock or fund, in economics generally, the accumulated wealth either of a man or a community that is available for earning interest and producing fresh wealth. Our interest is for you to see how broad this capital is. And further down it says it is the increment of wealth or means of substance analogous to the increment of population and of the wants of civilized man. Please take note of civilized man, and going further down it says, the capitalist or laborer capitalist serves by abstaining from consumption, by denying himself the present enjoyment of more or less of his means of consumption in the prospect of a future profit. But our interest is where it tells us again that no progress can be made in any sphere, small or large, without reserved funds possessed by few or more persons in small or large amounts, and the progress in all cases is adventured under self-deprival in the meanwhile of acquired value and more or less risk as to the final result. Our interest for you here to note is the few. It has to be possessed by few or more, but the emphasis has to be on few. And then going further, it tells us about things like capital punishment. You need to go examine what these are and what they mean and imply, especially when it concerns the slave trade. Remember, you couldn't have considered the Negroes as capitalists because they were the victims of it. So there is no way you could consider a slave who is laboring for massa to have been a capitalist. And so further down here, we see where it says the severity of barbarian and feudal laws was mitigated so far as common law offenses were concerned by the influence of the church as the inheritor of Christian traditions and Roman jurisprudence. Our interest is for you to see the barbarian side of the feudalism and to research and find out if those countries who lived by it have stopped using it or they are still using it till today and of course till tomorrow morning. Let us also reference The Wealth of Nations in two volumes, Volume 2 by Adam Smith, and this was published 1910, and there we are told that in other countries rent and profit eat up wages and the two superior orders of people oppress the inferior one. So we want you to note the two superior orders of people and the inferior one. Remember, these are all parts of feudal capitalism. You need to understand the slave master very, very well and remember that oppression is part of his system. He can't live without it. Now remember, somebody cannot be telling you how you are both human, but he considers a part of the human family inferior. But he cannot provide enough reason unless he foments or creates problems to justify that reason. But going forward, it says, but in new colonies, the interest of the two superior orders obliges them to treat the inferior one with more generosity and humanity, at least where that inferior one is not in a state of slavery. So what we want you to take note of here is where it says that inferior one is not in a state of slavery. Take very good note of it. We shall come back to it much later. Let us also reference A Critical Examination of Socialism by W.H. Mallock, and it was published 1908. And there we are told that capital, however, as thus understood, has, he says, this peculiarity, that being labor in an externalized and also in a permanent form, it is capable of being detached from the laborers and appropriated by other people, and the essence of modern capitalism is neither more nor less than this, the appropriation of the instruments of production by a minority who are not producers. Take very good note of this. This is why you see that the slave master that was using the Negroes to produce everything claims to have also been the one that produced those things. You need to understand who the slave master is. And if you studied European history when you were in school, you would have been taught about the British system of feudalism, and you will see those things they talk about in the feudal triangle. What you look at, you see the monarch, the kings and queens, barons and knights, freemen and serfs. You always have to remember that the serfs and the slaves are usually in number, and that explains the feudal triangle, and you can see that the base is usually wider than the peak. Deuteronomy 15:6, the code. Remember, the Chinese are not Christians or Muslims or Jews, but here they are. So without going into much detail, let's just look at what that code in Deuteronomy 15:6 says. For the Lord thy God blessed thee as he promised thee, and thou shalt lend unto many nations, but thou shalt not borrow. And thou shalt reign over many nations, but they shall not reign over thee. So our challenge to you is, when you look at the country like Nigeria, for example, where there are some people born to rule, where there are some people used by the slave masters to impose foot soldiers, to impose lackeys, to impose stooges on them, who is this place talking about? The slave master or the slaves? And please remember, it says, they shall not borrow. They shall reign over many nations, but they shall not reign over thee. Take note of that again very well, and look at how many places the slave master has conquered with his lies and propaganda. And then we move to Psalm 68 verse 31. Princes shall come out of Egypt. Ethiopia shall soon stretch out her hands unto God. And we ask you, have you ever wondered what these mean? These are all codes, believe them or not, because you can't be telling us that somebody in Nigeria, for example, in the south, where the slave master's weapons are doing their damages, could be singing the same song with the northerners through whom the slave master uses those weapons. He gives it to them, he trains the army, he equips the army. The same army was also the slave hunting militia. So how can you say the people are the same and that they should be saying this same thing? But remember, you may have heard Ethiopia and you're wondering, what the hell are these insane people at the Renaissance talking about in Ethiopia? And your mind goes to the Ethiopia, formerly Abyssinia of today. But let us reference the history of slavery and the slave trade, ancient and modern, the African slave trade and the political history of slavery in the United States, edited by W.O. Blake, and this was published 1860. And there we are told that Negroland or Negritia, which is what you call Nigeria today, is that part of the interior of Africa stretching from the Great Desert on the north to the unascertained commencement of Kaffirland on the south, and from the Atlantic on the west to Abyssinia on the east. Now remember, we told you that this whole lockdown, this whole COVID, whatever the slave master is doing, is targeted at southern Nigeria and at Biafra and Ambazonia, and we stand by it. Remember, it's okay to call us insane, call us conspiracy theorists, call us what you may. Time will show what we're saying and prove it beyond any reasonable doubt. So we won't waste time trying to prove it to you. You will see it manifest in your own very eyes. It goes further to say, in fact, the entire interior of this great continent may be called the land of the Negroes. The ancients distinguished it from the comparatively civilized countries lying along the coast of the Mediterranean and the Red Sea by calling the latter Libya and the former Ethiopia. So now remember, there were two sides. Remember also, like we told you, during the slave trade, this place wasn't called Africa as a whole. It was Ethiopia. But then when they were done, they quickly rebrand. But our interest is to show you how they rebrand. At least you have seen how they are doing their COVID-19 today. And if tomorrow they wake up and ask their foot soldiers to start capturing the Negroes again, they are going to do the same thing. They will even be happy to do it. Our interest is to show you how the whole thing worked with what is happening today anyways. But further down is where our interest lies. And it says, it is upon Ethiopia in an especial manner that the cause of slavery has fallen. So when they tell you Ethiopia, you will be thinking the Ethiopia of today. But when you look at them, you will see that they are not Negroes. And if you looked at someone like Haile Selassie, he was supposed to be an emperor of Abyssinia, never of Ethiopia. But the slave master played his smart move there. But that's subject of a different video. But going further, it says, at first, it bore but a share of the burden, that is the Ethiopians, which is the Negroes you know today. Brethons and Sethians were the fellow slaves of the Ethiopian. But at last, all the other nations of the earth seemed to conspire against the Negro race. So that's our interest. So if you are looking at what they are showing you as happening all over the world, you have to remember that they conspired against the Negro race, agreeing never to enslave each other, but make the blacks the slaves of all alike. Again, we challenge you to find out who it was that invited the Chinese to Nigeria. That's all we want you to show us. Remember, if the slave masters media of CNN, Al Jazeera, BBC, Xinhua, or whatever you call the Chinese media, does not report about Biafra and Ambazonia, but they are quick to report about the Chinese allegedly oppressing Negroes and blacks. We don't want to use African because, like you have seen, African was a newer term. They were never all called African during the slave trade. The reason they adopted that other name is to deceive everybody, so that while you are thinking African, they are still doing what they are doing. The same way they use Nigerian as a cover for what they are doing presently. So we want you to think deeply and ask yourself, who do you think could have been the one inviting the Chinese while supposedly their own people are dying there, being oppressed, being identified as being behind the virus, yet they are inviting the same Chinese? Do you think it could have been the same people? If you think it could have been the same people, please put it in the comment section. Like we told you before, we still tell you again today. When they did their alleged evacuation of Nigerians from South Africa, we told you it was a lie. We wanted you to challenge us. We wanted you to prove us wrong. You notice that they used the same flight they used for that one. That's because it's pure fake. But then, the one of the Chinese has a deeper meaning than you are seeing. They are just trying to pass on a message. You will hear some people from so-called African Americans, they will say they visited somewhere in Africa, they came with a white woman, and the people were rushing the white woman, trying to help her do one thing or the other and ignoring the blacks. Those are how those messages are passed across. We shall examine it in a subsequent video. Our interest is to ask you again, who do you think invited those Chinese to Nigeria? Before you create a video condemning the invite, why not start looking at who invited them? And then he goes further to say, thus, this race of human beings has been singled out, whether owing to the accident of color or to their peculiar fitness for certain kinds of labor, for infamy and misfortune, and the abolition of the practice of promiscuous slavery in the modern world was purchased by the introduction of a slavery confined entirely to Negroes. So our interest is to use what is happening today to prove it to you that they are still working with their brainless foot soldiers and that they are doing the same thing, and we will show you where they are heading to. You don't need to believe us yet. When they get there, you will say, we remember what these people told us. But before we move on from this chapter, let us remind you that these slave trade they are talking about, the Moors and the Arabs, introduced it before the Europeans joined them, and then of course they all worked through the same group. But reading further here, you see where it tells us that the Arabs and Moors indeed, traversing the latter, knew something about Ethiopia or the land of the Negroes, but what knowledge they had was confined to themselves, and to the Europeans the whole of the continent to the south of the desert was an unknown and unexplored land. There were traditions of two ancient circumnavigations of the continent by the Phoenicians and the Carthaginians, one down the Red Sea and round the Cape of Good Hope from the east, and the other through the Straits of Gibraltar. Those are not our interests. Our interest is for you to see that they claim that the Arabs and Moors knew something about Ethiopia that the Europeans did not know. That's not our interest, but we just want you to take note of the fact that the place was not even called Africa at that time. So when you hear them saying Africans, Africans, it is deliberate, and we will show you what they are doing. But then you take note of this, you hear some so-called African Americans today claiming to be Moors. Moors were brutal slave hunters. We believe the Moors metamorphosed to what you call Fulani today, because the Fulanis appeared from nowhere and the Moors disappeared to nowhere. And this also sends us back to the question, who do you think invited the Chinese? And why do you think the slave masters made a show of it? They invited them, they showed you on TV, also showed you in the slave masters media how they were treating the Negroes there, and showed you how Nigeria also came to take the Chinese. Where are those Chinese today? So you need to start asking yourself what may be going on. So let us also reference the Gospel on the Banks of the Niger, journals and notices of the native missionaries accompanying the Niger expedition of 1857 to 1859 by the Reverend Samuel Crowder and the Reverend John Christopher Taylor, and this was published in 1859. And there we are told that the promise is sure for us, the idols he shall utterly abolish. We look beyond to the promise which was long predicted with intense earnestness, and faithful is he that had promised it. Ethiopia shall soon stretch out her hands to God. May God in mercy hasten this time in our day for his son Jesus Christ's sake. This is what they were saying when they were imposing their golden calf on the Negroes. And remember, when you hear Ethiopia today, you will be thinking of Abyssinia or the Ethiopia that you see today. They will tell you how the oldest Bible is there. You won't remember to ask when was printing invented, where and when, and how could they be having the oldest Bible? Who printed it and how was it handwritten? So you see them deceiving you because they understand that the Negro is very spiritual. He is very religious. But then, going forward from the same book, it says, I cannot close this interesting visit to Nsube. Nsube is in what is called Anambra State in Nigeria today, or Enugu State, whichever one it is, in southern Nigeria, without one or two remarks. I had often read the promise, Ethiopia shall soon stretch out her hands unto God with deep interest, but not until this day did I feel its force when there sat before me a congregation of pure Africans who had met together to worship the God of the universe. Now, remember, what the slave master brought is the golden calf, which we shall prove to you beyond any reasonable doubts. You don't need to believe us yet. And so you see the use of Africans here, from Ethiopian to Africans. Remember, they have to continue changing the identity of the Negroes so as to prevent them from knowing what the past looked like. For example, if you remember that the civil rights movement was by Negroes or Black Americans, today they are called African Americans. Your children from school will be taught about African Americans in a way they choose. They may not be able to connect it with the Negroes or the Ethiopians or whoever they were before then. That's how the slave master's iterations work with his lies and propaganda. And he goes forward to say, here for the first time, the joyful news of salvation was announced and the people seemed to enjoy it. Again, if Ethiopia must hear the untold mysteries of the gospel, by whom must they hear them? It cannot be otherwise but by her own sons and daughters. There is no cause to fear in the Igbo district. The people are ready to receive the gospel from the mouth of their own children. Now remember, that's how they conditioned Crowther and then used him to propagate their lies to the Negroes. Because they tried for over 300 years and didn't succeed. And unfortunately, as you would imagine, those who kept the laws of the Most High as the people understood it then were protected, but they never knew. But the slave master was looking for a way to decoy them away from the true knowledge and interaction with the Almighty. That's why he brought them the golden calf, which we shall continue to show you and ultimately prove to you beyond any reasonable doubts that the slave master brought a golden calf. And so the same way they changed the names and appellations and identities of the Negroes and changed the identities of nations is the same way they will talk about capitalism and feudalism, and they are just slavery and the slave trade repackaged and remodeled so that you won't understand, and before you realize what they are doing, they move on to the next stage. Capitalism, slavery and COVID-19. Remember, the Arabs and Moors capitalized on the weakness of a group to capture and sell the Negroes as slaves. We want to assume that that group no longer exists today, even though the Arabs did it directly themselves. But there is a splinter Arab group that they used to propagate their religion and impose their religion on people who had nothing to do with the religion. So we just refer to the group as the group. And it is through them that the Chinese were invited to Nigeria. You need to understand what is going on. It is through them that the operation is exported from Europe and America to Nigeria as well. You need to understand who those people are. But then, the Europeans capitalized on the weakness of the same group to capture and sell the Negroes as slaves. The Chinese are coming and capitalizing on the weakness of the same group to do the same. That's again why we challenge you to tell us who it was that invited the Chinese to Nigeria. Remember, the minister denied being behind it. So the question becomes, who did? That should be the question. Could it have been the president? Could it have been the vice? Who actually did? Those are questions you have to ask. And do you remember when we said you should just look at the foot soldiers if you wanted to know whether there was any real threat to humanity? by this pandemic or plandemic. You remember that? Did you notice that the British politicians that claimed to have tested positive to the virus did not die? None of them actually died. And permit us to even ask you, do you know any prominent Chinese politician or prominent Chinese anywhere that actually died of the same virus? Your answer would certainly be no. Do you also know any prominent Italian politician or American politician that also died of the same virus? Your answer will certainly be no. And also keep in view that the slave master described his brainless foot soldiers as genius in leadership, in rulership, or whatever he chose to label them as. But the term genius couldn't have been mentioned even on the same page with this group. So did you also notice that they did not even mass vaccinate the whole of UK over it? And remember, the British Parliament did not sit down and start making a law for a vaccine or forced vaccination of people whenever the vaccine comes out. Remember, the people making the laws are the brainless foot soldiers. They lack humanity, they lack common sense, and there is no better way to say it. Now, they are making the law so that when the slave master passes on whatever he gives them, including the poison he will produce as vaccine, they will put it on people and then turn around to say they lack common sense. They did it themselves. That's all they are trying to do. So again, permit us to ask you, why then are the slave master's foot soldiers in Nigeria making laws for mandatory vaccination of people? Have you wondered why? They were also supposed to empower the military to force vaccinate you if you don't agree. Have you wondered why they are doing it? Now, you will be thinking, oh no, they are the same people. No, we are not the same people. We are never the same people. We have never been the same people. But that you see them as the same people does not mean it is the same people. And remember, it is their ability to hide and act as enemies within that they leverage on their oppression of the Negroes. You will notice that the so-called African Union or whatever rubbish they have there will be telling you how they want Africa to come together, they want to be united. Those are all controlled. They are made to say it but do nothing about it. You will notice that they don't ever talk about Biafra or Ambazonia. And you remember also that it's only a fool that somebody else will be killing your own people in their hundreds with weapons made by the slave masters, and you are busy talking about one people becoming one, doing the same thing, building one economy, but you are not talking about the killings. That should tell you who they are. Those people you are hearing speaking as if they are speaking for Africans, those are all controlled individuals. So then, do you also remember when the Nigerian army, which was incidentally a slave hunting militia until 1863, terrorized people in southern Nigeria to force them to stay indoors over the lockdown? Remember that? And you remember the question we asked, why do you believe the same army that kills people for asking for freedom stands by as Fulani herdsmen murder hundreds, now cares about their victims that they would not want a virus or a pandemic or pandemic, if you choose, from the slave masters not to kill them? Do you remember that question? And if you remember them, all we can tell you now is please stay safe. Please stay safe. Please stay safe. But then, based on what you see in Nigeria, do you still believe there is a genuine threat out there? And if you said yes, why then do you think the government in Nigeria, for example, is forcing people to claim to be COVID-19 positive? Now, some people will tell you, yes, there is the virus, but the government is playing politics with it. Remember, those governments are not spirits, they are humans. They are also susceptible to death or the virus or the sickness, whichever one you choose. So why do you think they are not scared of it but are interested in rolling out figures? All those figures you are hearing from Nigeria as COVID-19 patients are fake. None of them is correct. They just keep concocting those figures every day and showing people. That's all they are doing. And if you are still in doubt as to why we told you that this is a game between the slave master and his brainless foot soldiers, remember the analogy we gave you at that time was how the British Prime Minister, the British Prince Charles, and the British Health Minister all claim to have tested positive to the virus. And then, within the same period, their foot soldiers in Nigeria started claiming to be the same. El-Rufai, a Fulani, claimed to have tested positive to it. Abba Kyari, an Arab or Fulani or Kanuri, which are all of the same Berber race we are talking about here, now was said to have also tested positive of it. And if you remember, their burial in Nigeria, people have debunked the corpse. They claimed that that wasn't his corpse. And if you looked at their grave and the people around the grave, you'll see that there were no PPEs. You will see that it was a well-orchestrated game. That should tell you that there's a game they are playing. And even at that, even if he had died, we didn't see any autopsy. Nobody knows what killed him. Anything could have killed him. Yar'Adua died. He was a president. Nobody knows what killed him. Abacha died. He was a president. Nobody is sure what killed him. So there is no way to tell us that it could have been COVID-19, as if to say, if they didn't come up with this pandemic, the man wouldn't have died. That's ideally what they are suggesting. So if you still remember how the military was killing people in the south, beating old people that came out to look for food over the lockdown, and today you are seeing the northerners flooding the south, if that doesn't tell you that it is the enemy within they want to achieve through this lockdown, because they work with the slave master, believe it or not. If you remember, during the Biafran war, it was the same thing. And you can very easily see that it is the slave master's foot soldiers, like the Fulanis, of course, the Barbers, the Kanuris, those are the same Barbar race. But then they use the Hamitic group against the Negroes. And what you are seeing would be the COVID-19 jihad. You may not understand it, you may not even believe it, but before you come out of that lockdown, which the slave master has carefully engineered for his foot soldiers to deploy, to take advantage of, to capitalize on. Remember, we started this with capitalism. To capitalize on this lockdown, plant themselves and act as enemies within, then the starvation which they deployed extensively in the 60s will be deployed to subdue that area. Just watch and see, so that you understand why they describe their foot soldiers as genius. Remember, they are geniuses in the negative direction. And in the event you are doubting us, remember, this was the same people that captured and sold the Negroes as slaves between themselves. It was the same people that served children to death with British support in the Biafra genocide of 1967-70. So if you're expecting anything called humanity, if you're expecting love or kindness from them, you are wasting your time. It doesn't matter how you doubt us, but you're going to see it play out in your eyes. Those people lack humanity. They lack common sense, and there is no better way to say it. And they deployed the lockdown with their foot soldiers to carry out the conquest, and they have deployed the starvation again. You may not understand it, you may not even believe it, but again, remember, the moment the British politicians claimed to have tested positive, the Nigerian foot soldiers claimed the same. It's a planned game. If they didn't plan it, they wouldn't be saying it. So permit us to digress completely from what we are talking about now, and then go into a story we told you about in the past. Do you remember this woman? We are going to play back the video. Please listen to it and tell us why you still believe that the threat or the virus is real. We want you to note and remember that the Tanzania or so had fired their health minister. The reason being that the test kits were not producing correct results. They tested it with animal blood and everything, and they produced the same thing. And remember, that's the same thing they will do in Nigeria, because their foot soldiers, they lack humanity, they lack common sense. So they will give them any test kit. The test kit may be designed in such a way that whatever thing you put there, it will give you a result of their choice randomly. So that's why you notice that everyone they had accused of being coronavirus positive ends up being negative. So ideally, what they may resort to doing is to kill those people so that they can tell you that coronavirus killed them. Remember, these are the slave hunters of old. If you remember how the army was killing people to force them to stay indoors, that should tell you exactly what we're talking about. You don't need to believe us, but listen to the woman first.
Hello everyone. This is Susan Idoko Openi Lawani. I am pleading with everybody to please tell Nigerian government to let me go. This is my 16th day of incarceration. What have I done? Benue State lied on me that I have COVID-19. I just got the result yesterday. After 15 days, I just got the result yesterday. And the result is a stage play with different dates, bed days, different recordings which they themselves know and try to put right. That's left to them. But please, I want to beg Nigerians, I want to beg Nigerians to also beg President Buhari or Shibanjo, the health minister Osage, and whoever is in charge, to please let me go out of this place. I am tired, I am fed up, I am exhausted. I don't know what to do anymore. I don't know why they're keeping me. That they want to treat me. Treat me for what? What are they treating me for? I am not sick. They have seen the result that they lied about, and they are not letting me go. They want to treat me because I don't even trust Nigerians. I don't trust anybody. If you've been lied against, if results have been fortified, how do you trust anybody to treat you with anything? Do I just sit down and start taking medicine? Please, Nigerians, as you can see, I'm recording from where I'm incarcerated. This is my 16th day. Please beg the minister, beg the president, or whoever is concerned to get me out of this place.
And so, in the event you never knew about this woman and her case, she was arrested in Nigeria and accused of being COVID-19 positive. Remember, most of those people that assess them are not even doctors. But the slave master's propaganda eats deep into the fabric of his brainless foot soldiers. So if you are sick in that place, for example, now, and you were to make it to hospital, you might not even get treatment because the doctors will all run away thinking that you are COVID positive. That's the biggest danger in what is going on. But then the slave master has his plans with his brainless foot soldiers, which is to conquer and infiltrate the South with his Fulanis, who are the slave master's main allies in unleashing terror on the Negroes and the slave trade as well. They did it all together. They also connived to misinform everyone about it. So please listen to the discussion with somebody we don't know, with the same woman and the patient, and they moved her from one isolation center to another. So please just listen and tell us you still believe there is a genuine threat out there. And here we come to the end of this limited edition of this series. We thank you very much for listening, and we encourage you to find time to look for the materials referenced and study them yourself. Thank you very much once again for listening. Peace.